You want to start this? Do you want to prompt them?
Like a
So first of all, introduce yourself. Who are you? How long have you been at TACC?
Oh, wow. Geez. hello, everybody. I'm Dr. Tommy Minyard. I'm Director of Advanced Computing Systems at the Texas Advanced Computing Center. I've been here for over 20 years at TACC. Started in the High Performance Computing Group and have moved over into the systems team and worked very closely with the user services and the high performance computing folks to ensure people run appropriately on the production systems.
I'm Remy Scott. I am in the user services group. My focus is on the user experience. If you've ever submitted a ticket to TACC, there's a non-zero chance I have answered it. Been here about 12 years. Started as a desktop support technician. Have been a sysadmin, have worked in the HPC group, and now, like I said, in user services. Mm-hmm. So, and yeah, we work closely.
Did I hire you? I think I hired you.
You were part of my hire, absolutely, all those many years ago. Yes. I can't believe how the time has gone by. But yeah, so one thing that happens a lot in my world is we get tickets, right? And a lot of these, well, I don't know if it's a lot, but you know, a number of these tickets are from users who have managed to get themselves into a situation on one of our TACC resources where we've had to take measures to prevent whatever they've done from occurring again.
Yes.
And I think basically probably what it boils down to is the user's job has done something to affect these shared resources, these shared tools, right? Such as things like the login nodes, right?
File system, storage. Hardware.
Yes, very memory common. Constraints. Right. You know, we definitely see a lot of users who might be unaware of the fact that they're actually running on a shared resource.
This is one of the big challenges with running these big shared resources and large supercomputing systems. People don't always realize that there's hundreds of other users also logged in doing their own work and their own activities trying to get their research done. And when we get some new users and some more, non-savvy users that haven't used systems like this in the past, then they all of a sudden stumble into these gotchas. The most common one is, you know, we end up seeing people running applications on the login nodes.
Right.
And the login nodes are, shared resources. We've got hundreds of users on it. And we try to make people understand, like, look, if you try to run an MPI job on the login nodes and you're using all the cores, well, if everybody on the logins did that, then the logins would become unusable.
Sure.
And it's important people to understand that you're welcome to run stuff on the system, you just have to do it on the compute nodes and not on the actual login node environment. And usually once we educate them point them to the right tools, they usually can run appropriately.
Yeah, I try to explain to the users like the login nodes are best used for kind of almost like housekeeping.
Right, housekeeping, compiling, getting your applications ready to go, editing your job scripts.
Sure.
Don't even use them for debugging. You know, we have the development queue and other resources that users can debug their applications with.
Support note, IDEV, folks. Use IDEV. Yes.
Highly recommend it. It's a nice interactive development environment. And then you don't have to worry about running on logins or anything.
Well, indeed. And you know, I think that you can say even something to the effect of like, make sure your job runs on one or two nodes before you take 400 nodes and try to run scale.
Right.
Yes.
Scale up. That's the other big thing too is people don't understand that sometimes they get access to a very big resource.
Yeah.
And they get a lot. It's a lot more powerful than they might have on their desktop.
Sure.
And they don't realize that as they start to use more nodes, the impact it can have not only on the system itself, but also impacting other users and what they're trying to get done on the system.
Yeah, that's a good point.
And that leads into the other common issue that we have with users, and that's file systems.
Yeah.
We provide these very high-end storage resources, but we can't always control the level of performance per user.
Right.
And we just don't have the mechanisms for that. So that means that users can get access to a whole lot of bandwidth to the storage subsystems. But if they're consuming all that bandwidth, that means they're impacting other users that are also trying to get access to the file systems.
Sure.
And so the other ones that we typically have common where users get suspended or banned from the systems is they overwhelm the storage in some way, shape, or form.
Right. Too many reads, too many writes, things like
that. Or too many I/O requests, yes. Opening and closing files, we've stumbled into applications that they work well on one node, but all of a sudden you start running on 16 nodes with 56 tasks per node. All of a sudden, every task is trying to open and close lots of files or the same file, and that can cause havoc on the file systems where, you know, either all the storage servers get overloaded and then that impacts and degrades performance for everybody, or one server gets completely overwhelmed out of all the dozens of storage servers, and all of a sudden anybody trying to access data on that one server, they get stuck and they have to wait. And, yep. You know, we have to fight that all the time. And again, it's just, you know, something to think about when you're a new user coming onto these systems is think about, well, what am I doing IO-wise? And as I use more and more resources, how is that going to scale? A lot of times users don't realize it, but if you're doing all IO, you're not performing. Your computations aren't making progress, right? And right. So you're just waiting in IO, and so your performance is going to be poor anyway.
Sure.
So it's important when you're, you know, coming onto these systems and working on these shared resources, just to keep in mind that it's very easy to dominate the resources because it's a lot of power and a lot of performance available at your fingertips.
Sure. And there's no real indication that you're really using a shared resource.
It's almost impossible for us to feed back that information to you. It's only that the administrators see that, the servers are getting overwhelmed. They're being slow to respond to requests. We do get notification and alerted when that happens.
Sure.
But then we have to go in, figure out, what's going on? Who's causing all these requests? Why is there so much load? And then track it back. And that does take some time.
It does, yeah. And there are times when we do have to, you know, suspend queues unannounced because you guys are troubleshooting.
Right.
You know, and we don't really, we have to address it as soon as possible.
Right.
Because I kind of see it like a domino effect. You know, when we say it's affecting other users, I mean, it could even make other users' jobs time out,
right.
Things like that.
Exactly, because they get paused or they get stuck, and some users dominating the InfiniBand fabric with high speed interconnect, or they're dominating the storage.
Yeah,
it can certainly impact what other folks are trying to do.
And usually that equates to more tickets.
Right. So, we're trying to make everybody's lives easier here and reduce the overall load on the tickets and requests, and also so that people just don't stumble into these traps and get suspended from the system and don't realize why.
Right.
Suspended.
Yeah, so we do end up doing a lot of educating on that back end when users do something to end up temporarily disabled from submitting jobs to the queues. But, you know, the good news is we do have resources online. We've got some user guides that kind of detail the things we're talking about today.
Right.
They're always useful resources. We have tons of documentation, system specific, center specific, a little more broader. You know, we have tools too that can help out users.
Right.
You know, like if they are hammering the file system or if they need to monitor their jobs, you know, for
collect statistics of the jobs, performance of the jobs. We do have access to tools that
we
can point users to say, hey, we see you're doing a lot of IO. You know, you're doing it all the time. Maybe if you reduce the frequency of your output, then that will help with performance and impacting other folks on the system.
Yeah, it's just efficiency, you know.
Right.
I mean, again, you know, we're here to help. We're here to help you tune your job files as well. You know, I think a lot of times people think like, well, if I can take 512 nodes in 48 hours, by golly, I'm going to do it.
Do it, right.
You know, but like we said earlier, you know, make sure your job runs on two nodes for 20 minutes before you grab 400 for 48 hours.
Our job is to provide the resources for the users, but we also want to ensure that the users are getting effective and efficient usage of the resources. They're very expensive resources. We only can consume so many computer cycles, and if your application isn't performing, isn't scaling, isn't using the resources efficiently, we want to help fix that and make sure that you're able to get the performance and we can deliver more science on the systems because we're not having to do fighting performance, and we're making sure you're getting effective use of the nodes. Just to think about, you know, I know you log into some of these nodes like Lone Star, and you see 128 cores on those login nodes. That doesn't mean you should compile and use all 128 cores when you're doing your makes and your compiles. You know, you really don't need to use more than maybe 32 or 64.
True.
So something else is to play nicely in that way, and just to play nice on the system.
I mean, a lot of times I even suggest users grab a compute node and to compile.
Right.
You know? And you can even craft a job script
and
to
have it all compile in the job script.
All do it automatically, you know, put it into the scheduler, let it queue up and do its thing, you know, without, you know, way less risk of impacting other users or the, you know, bigger sections of the system. So
I do have to admit one of the newer challenges we're seeing on some of these systems is dealing with the GPUs. You know, it's an additional device inside the nodes and some mechanisms, you know, we've put system settings on all the compute nodes to try to prevent users from running them out of memory, causing them to crash, you know, causing problems to happen with the devices on the nodes. And the GPUs have actually introduced a additional point of potential failure in the nodes that we're trying to mitigate. And unfortunately, some of the limitations we put, like on memory, we can't enforce on the GPU nodes because of the way it allocates and things. So users can actually run those nodes out of memory. So another thing to keep in mind is if you're running jobs and you see your jobs are failing or something is happening and you know your jobs are not completing successfully, they're getting stuck, you know, they might not, you know, you may not be getting any output. Don't keep running the jobs repeatedly. Submit a ticket. Yeah. Let us know. We may have to work with you to figure out what's going on with the compute nodes, why they're failing. And you may not see it from your side. And believe me, it's hard from a user point of view because we can't expose a lot of the system level activity.
Sure.
And so, you know, it may require some administrator or an HPC consultant to dig into the jobs and what's going on.
We're here for that too.
And that's exactly. And you know, and like I said, with these GPUs, we're finding these new failure modes and new ways that they can hang or not behave or not perform. And like, you know, we have these nodes with three GPUs in it, and all of a sudden one GPU has gone sideways.
Gets borked and the whole thing.
It starts eating jobs and causing failures. And we're going to have to, you know, figure out these new failure
modes. And as we know, GPUs aren't going anywhere.
No, they're not going anywhere. Be prepared. They're more coming.
Exactly. But yeah, you know, respect the limits of the system constraints. Right. And like I said, we're here for you. You can submit tickets easily through your TACC user dashboard on the TACC website. You know, we operate, basically we're a 9-to-5 shop on the tickets, Monday to Friday. But yeah, we're here for all your needs. Please do not hesitate to submit a ticket. Don't wait until
you've been suspended.
You've been temporarily suspended to put in a ticket. Right. You know, try to stay ahead of that if you can.
So, yeah. All right.